Welcome back to another episode of Behind a Short. I'm your host, Bussy Malat, and today we're going to take a look at the cinematography breakdown of our short horror film, Stranded. Now, as always, this is going to be a spoiler-heavy episode, so if you haven't seen the short film yet, be sure to check it out in the corner above. So just a really quick piece of technical information before we jump in. We did shoot this short film on a single Blackmagic Pocket 4K using Blackmagic RAW and 5:1 compression. I personally feel that 5:1 compression is a really nice balance between quality and file sizes. 12:1 tends to fall apart in lower light scenarios, and I only do 3:1 when doing effects heavy shots because of the file sizes. So with all that being said, let's jump into the actual cinematography of Stranded.
Kind of a disaster, right?
So we open up here on a shot of a pumpkin. Now, this was originally supposed to be a shot of the car, since the entire idea of the short is a woman being stranded in her car. We initially tried doing a panning shot to reveal Danny and Liz coming out of the building, but this shot was just way too long and boring. And we also thought about doing a simple cut, but that wasn't nearly as effective since we did not have access to the inside of the building, and it felt weird simply cutting to them just walking down the sidewalk without seeing them actually exit the building. So we settled on this shot, which is probably better because it A, sets the tone of the piece with a nice jump scare to start off, B, it's concise and allows us to establish the characters leaving off screen, and C, it's a nice bit of foreshadowing to the killer in the pumpkin mask. So this tracking shot was shot on the DJI Ronin S, and our key light is a Light Panels Astra bicolor covered with a soft box and some blue gels just off to the right side of the screen. This is giving us a nice soft key light that is covering a large area, and the blue gel is giving it more of a moonlight look. Now, since this was a super low budget short film and we only had a couple of battery powered lights, we blocked this scene so that we could take advantage of the practical lights as back or hair lights. So for instance, with this shot of Liz's coverage, we had her step to where we could get the best practical lighting on her. So if we took this image, we can see the key is illuminating her face here, giving it sort of a bluish tint. And then we have our street light practical, which is hitting her hair and back right here and giving her some nice separation from the background. There's actually another practical just behind Danny, which is illuminating the ground back here, as well as giving our character just a nice soft edge light on the left side of her face. This is another Ronin-S tracking shot, but for this we had her just walk through an area that was well lit by practicals. And here again, this is another shot that is entirely lit by practicals, but I think that this could be a useful lesson. Now, you might be saying, this entire parking lot is lit by practicals. How hard can this scene be? Well, this is a very large parking lot with a lot of lights and also a lot of dark areas as well. So we spent a decent amount of time looking at different areas of the lot and looking for the best angle that would give us some nice depth. So if we look at this shot right here, we have some daylight balanced practicals off to the side, which are illuminating the asphalt and our subject. And then we have these tungsten practicals in the background, which is lighting up areas in our background and also creating a silhouette of this darker area in the middle of the lot. Then we have the city lights lighting up the sky, which is giving us a really soft edge light on the trees here. So the lesson here is that even if you're using practical lights to light your scene, you should be location scouting intelligently and taking the time to find the areas with the best complementary lighting to tell your story. Look for areas that create depth and take the time to block your actors through the scene in the space. Your images are going to be instantly more cinematic if you take the time to plan your shots rather than just shooting it. So we're gonna jump ahead here to the shot of the killer outside of the building, which was actually our hardest shot to light, which required the most lights of the entire shoot. Using the key straight on was creating too much light on our subject, and we wanted to make sure this area stayed kind of dark so it would be moodier. Simply adjusting the brightness, we were still faced with the same problem. He was either too lit or too dark. To fix this, we bounced our key light into a reflector, which was bouncing the light back and giving us a really soft look that still felt moody and dark, but still gave us enough detail. Additionally, we have a small handheld light set up as a backlight just off screen to mimic this tungsten light that's illuminating this tree in the background. This helps give the killer just a bit of separation to make him pop out from the background. Our third light is set up off this corner and is being used as a kicker light to accent the knife. Without this kicker light here, the knife became completely lost in the shadows and was really hard to see. But with it, it creates definition around the knife and then also gives us that cliched horror knife shimmer that we're so used to seeing. And lastly, for all of the car stuff, we used basically a single light. The light panels Astra set up right outside of the car. However, for certain shots, we did use our handheld lights as kicker lights to highlight certain parts of the image that we should be focusing on, such as shots with the keys or shots with the ignition. Now this shot with the pumpkin mask was actually pretty simple and was the entire reason that I really wanted a mask with the LED lights built into it. So we could have this nice face-off moment that creates a long sequence of tension before he starts slamming into the car. To do this, we have our key light set up off to the left here, which is making the right side of her face pop, and we have one of our small handheld lights set up just outside of frame as a catch light for her pupil. The LED mask is a bright enough light source that it causes the glass to reflect it, which in turn created my favorite image of the entire film. That's gonna do it for this week's episode. Just a really quick reminder here, we do have merch finally on sale, so check out our Thinking Art t-shirts, the Thinking Art hat, and we have Killer Be Killed posters and canvases in our store. So if you buy anything from our store, it directly goes into the short films that we produce and our filmmaking tutorials. And it's just a really nice way to help support our channel because everything we do is completely out of pocket. We don't have any sponsors. So whatever you can do to help support the channel, we greatly appreciate. So if you enjoyed this video, please like it, share it, subscribe to the channel, drop a comment below, and we'll see you next time with another episode of Behind the Short.